Blog Talk Radio.
Gentlemen, it is 8 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, and this is Off the Chain. I'm your host, Yvonne Mason. That was Lady Marmalade. That is one of my favorite all-time songs. It always makes me want to get up and dance. And since this is the last week before the beginning of the new year, I found it only fitting that we have something upbeat, something happy, something that makes you want to get up and dance. I cannot believe this year has gone by so fast. It was just the silly season last week. I mean, here we are at the end of 2017, and this has been one of the busiest years of my life. And I know that it has been a very busy year for everyone else, but it just seems like it's a bye. With that being said, y'all know every day I run the numbers for the show because this is your show. It's the listeners, it's my guest, it's your show. I'm just a facilitator. And when I ran the numbers this morning, I was about fell out of my chair. Just ladies and gentlemen, and this is the first show of the week, okay? Just on this show, we're at 84,691 listeners. Last night, we had 1,180 listeners, and that we didn't even run a show. These were people that listened to the archives. Just one night, 1,181 people tuned in to the archives and listened to the shows in the archives. I'm just blown away. When I add the PodTunes, YouTube, Stitcher, FM.com, TuneIn Radio, Podcast.com, Podcast Garden, SoundCloud, MixCloud, and Speaker, we have reached 105,535 listeners. Again, it just blew me away. 105,535 listeners. This show is growing so fast, it's like a runaway train with the engineer passed out from food coma or something. It's taken on its own life form, and I am so grateful and so appreciative for each and every one of you. In Australia, y'all are still our biggest listening base on this show. At 90%, y'all are our biggest listening base. And with that, I want to say thank you and to promote own the Teskey Brothers. They are a blues band, ladies and gentlemen, out of Australia that should be really on the streets of New Orleans. Clapton and Johnny Lang and B.B. King and Roy Orbison all rolled into one nice total package. If you haven't had the opportunity to go listen to them, please go listen to them. They're winning some big awards in Australia, Grammys and all the other music awards that are out there. Also, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to be on the show, it's already filled up through the middle of June. But if you want to be on the show, contact me at offthechainradio@yahoo.com. If you're of a shy nature and you want to get your feet wet, but you're not real sure about all of that, go to advertisecast.com and look at my rates. Look up Off the Chain on advertisecast.com. My rates are very reasonable, and you do get results. And with that being said, I have an ad that a young lady named Cece Chamberlain sent me through advertisecast.com. And she has a podcast. It's called www.podcast.com/InsideYourLifeWithCece. And what Cece's podcast is about, it's thought-provoking interviews, motivations, and inspirational to help and inspire others to lift up their soul. And it has feel-good stories in it, ladies and gentlemen. The conversations are to strengthen the mind, body, and the soul. And we all know that inspiration and motivation is few and far between for many, especially this time of the year. However, the Inside Your Life with Cece podcast is the glimmer of hope in a world that is full of confusion. And, you know, you get discouraged at times. You have faith. If you listen to her podcast, put a smile on your face. Cece's interviews will entertain you, uplift you, and bring in the absolute best out of the world. And there is good in the world, ladies and gentlemen. You just have to go look for it. So go to advertisecast.com, look up Off the Chain, and look my rates. And I will, ladies and gentlemen, run your ad for a solid month. And it doesn't matter how many shows I have in that month. Every night I have a show, I will run your ad. So you will get exposure in over 100 countries with over 105,000 plus listeners. January the 5th is vastly approaching. January the 5th at 9 o'clock. I've been saying 10 o'clock, but it's at 9 o'clock Eastern Standard Time on the Investigation Discovery Channel. They have a show. It's their new season called Married with Secrets. I will be on that show on January the 5th at 9 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. I will be discussing Gerard Schaefer, who was Florida's first serial killer. He was born in England. Killed 9 and 35 young women, and nobody knew it. Not his boss. He was a Martin County deputy. Not his boss, not his wife, not his family. And he kept it covered up until two girls got away. So tune in to that show on January the 5th at 9 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. And if you have not read the book, go and get Silent Scream by Yvonne Mason, because it talks about 9 of the victims that we know about. It is their story. So with that being said, we have a guest tonight. It's her first time, and she is wonderful. I just fell in love with her when I met her last year at an event we went to. She is one of the funniest women I've ever met in my life. She is a blogger. She's a personal assistant. She is an editor, and she is a writer. Terri Wilson is an award-winning short story author, and as I said, an editor, a personal assistant, a blogger, mother, and a wife. Now, I don't know where she finds time to do all of that, but God love her, she does. In a previous life, she taught secondary education, which is 7th to 12th, as well as college. And I'm going to tell you, the woman deserves a medal to teach 7 through 12 and then go and teach college. Terri has a master's degree in education and library information science. Her work in the library inspired her to learn more about the book world. And when she's not juggling her many hats, she can be found reading anything that tickles her fancy, but especially fantasy and steampunk. Terri's favorite books are ones with strong women who can take care of themselves, and she enjoys yoga and walking and considers herself a recycled hippie. Now, for those of you who are millennials, you do not have the corner market on hippies, because we were hippies before hippies was a word. We'll get around to that part of the story in a little bit. Welcome, Terri. So I am so glad you're here.
Well, thank you. I'm glad, too. Congratulations on your show. I mean, that is just really cool that you've got all that success. Well, our show. But, I mean, that's really good.
Because of y'all here and chatter all night, nobody would give two hoots. But because y'all continually come on along with you, kicking and screaming, we're successful, and I'm loving every minute of it, because I get to watch y'all bloom and grow and prosper and succeed and get heard by people you might not get heard. So thank you.
You're like a fairy godmother.
Well, I think that some people would call me a something else, but...
Well, we want to invite them on the show then.
Yeah, good idea. Let's talk a little bit about Miss Terri. Now, when you were growing up and you were plotting your course, as children, most of us do that, all except me. I never knew until I watched a few TV shows what I wanted to do, and it took me 50 some odd years to get there. But when you were growing up and you were plotting your course, did you have any idea that you were going to take this path, or did you always want to be a teacher?
Well, I can remember coming home. I was riding the bus. I lived out in the country when I was in second grade in elementary school. And so we were on the bus, and I can remember my best friend and I sat and talked about what we were going to do, and we talked about writing books. And so I can remember in second grade thinking that I was going to write a book. But I'm sure that by third grade, I probably wanted to be an astronaut or something else. And then fourth grade, it was probably a DJ or something. So I think I've wanted to write almost all my life. And as far as being a teacher goes, I didn't really know I wanted to do that. I just knew I wanted to help people and somehow make things a little bit better for others. And so teaching just kind of seemed like a natural fit for that.
When you were teaching, you taught some difficult grades, middle school, high school, and college. Middle school kids are too big to be little kids and too small to be big kids, and they're kind of stuck in the middle. And for some, it can be a very tough time, because you got the hormones kicking in, you got puberty kicking in, you got the boys liking the girls and the girls liking the boys, and it can be a mess. How in the world did you get through those years?
Well, I only taught the middle school for a couple semesters, and I was actually in the library when I did it, so that was totally different. Most of the kids who came to see me wanted to be in the library, either because they had to do a report or they were looking for something to read. And so I got to see them differently than like their real teacher would in their classroom. And if they misbehaved, I would just send them back to class. I didn't have to deal with it. So that was really, I didn't have the whole class, you know, day in and day out with middle school like I did. Now, I did teach high school, and ninth grade is really similar to middle school.
It is indeed, because they're, what, 14, 15, and they're really, they've really hit the confusion corner when they're that age. I wouldn't go back to being 15 for all the tea in China. I hated it when I was 15. I don't like it any better now.
No, I don't. And my oldest daughter is getting close to those years, and I'm just dreading them.
Go with God, my dear. Go with God. So how did that compare to college, to teaching college courses? Because even though I went back to college in my 50s, the attitude in college is, look, we're not babysitters. You either get it or you don't. And you're either here because you want to be here. Nobody makes you come to college. So if you're wasting your parents' money, you need to get out now. But if you want to be here, you'll get an education. Was teaching college tough for you? Did you find that it was easier to reach the kids that you had in your class?
Well, I actually, when I taught college, I taught teachers who were getting their master's degrees. So they had already had their bachelor's degrees. So they were a little bit of a different breed, I think, than like a 19 or 20-year-old student who's just sitting in a general education class.
Mm-hmm.
The thing I liked about teaching adults is you could, they got my jokes a lot quicker, and they would laugh, and you could have conversations. They were pretty serious as far as they would do the work. You didn't have to keep any of them after class because they didn't turn in their homework. If they didn't turn in their homework, then they just got a zero, and you just moved on. And it was more challenging intellectually just because they were adults too.
That
so
makes sense,
kind of,
because you had to be able to step ahead of them to keep your mind engaged.
Right.
Interesting. Now, your degree in library information science, for people that don't understand what that is, explain that to them. Because it's not just you go and get a degree and you're a librarian. There's more to it, I'm sure.
No. We in California, that's where I got my degree and that's where I lived at the time, there was a big push to make sure that the librarians in high schools and in elementary schools and stuff were certified teachers as well. So, but you had to get this extra training. And it wasn't just like how to alphabetize books. We learned about how to develop databases. We learned a lot about how to teach information skills. I specialized in working with youth as opposed to working in the corporate sector, a corporate library. And so a lot of what my classes revolved around were how to connect kids to reading, how to connect kids to books, what types of books were out there, how to teach the Google, if you can imagine or not, was just getting started. And so everybody thought Google was like the Holy Grail. And so we had to, do a lot of teaching for kids to show them that, you know, Google's not, just because it's the first hit on Google doesn't mean that it's a valuable resource that you could use for a project. And then just developing databases and a lot of just stuff like that. But it was a whole lot more than just being a librarian.
Here, go file it under the Dewey Decimal System, right? Now, when I was doing my research on you, I found out something really interesting. And when I read it, it tickled me because I know you, and I can just see this little girl in kindergarten being bored as hell and the teacher not knowing what to do with her. Tell our audience what happened. Lesson Terri is an extremely intelligent adult. So as a 5-year-old child, she was probably pretty precocious and probably asked a lot of questions, which drove the teachers insane. Am I right, Terri?
Yes, and we worked in like groups, and so there were 4 desks that were put together in a group, and I would get really frustrated. I would finish my work, but we couldn't go outside for recess until everybody in the group was finished. And so when the other kids didn't finish, I would just take over and do their work for them because I wanted to go outside and play. And so the school was overcrowded, and the teacher recommended that I move up to first grade. But the only problem was the kids in first grade were already reading a whole lot more than I was, and so I missed a little bit. So my mom actually ended up taking me out of that school, and I put back. And I didn't repeat kindergarten again, but I repeated like a half a year of first grade again to kind of catch up, even though I had the social skills and I was bossy as all get out, which I still am. I just needed to catch up a little bit academically.
I can see you doing that. Okay, since y'all aren't hurrying up and finishing, watch this. We're going outside and you're going to like it.
Yeah.
I read that, and I thought, yeah, that's Terri. Mm-hmm. Yep. Definitely Terri. Now, when you progressed in your life and you did the teaching thing, you did the library thing, and when did you actually get into working with books and writing and PAN, and for y'all that don't know what that is, you're not familiar with the literary world, a PA is a personal assistant. And they are a Girl Friday. They do all the heavy lifting for authors. They get them events. They get them on blogs. They get them on radio shows. They get their work out there for them, because really writers should just write, but because we're in the indie world, we have to think outside the box and do our own thing. So when did you start doing all this? What put you in that direction?
Well, it was early October of 2015, and I was an assistant manager for a convenience store chain. And they were trying to talk me into becoming a manager of the store. And I really didn't want to go down that path because it's a lot of hours. Mm-hmm. You know, when people call in, you got to go in and fill it in. So
yep.
I saw the manager, the current manager, just working a ton of hours for not a lot of money. And so I kind of had a decision that I needed to make. And I was talking with my husband about it one night, and he's like, "Well, what do you want to do? Do you want to go into management? Do you want to do this?" I'm like, "No, not really." He's like, "Well, what do you want to do?" And without even thinking about it, I just said, "Well, I want to write." And he said, "Okay, then go write." So I found out about NaNoWriMo a week before it started, and I sat down and did my first NaNo in October 2015, and we had a kickoff meeting. And Sherry Rensler, who is the author that I work for right now, she was the liaison person for this area. And so I met her, and she asked me to join her writing group, but it took me several months to get the courage to do it. And then so I joined her writing group in, like, spring of 2016. And then last year, she put out an announcement that she needed some help. And I thought it was going to be things like picking up her dry cleaning or running to the mail for her, just kind of simple things like that. And I thought, well, I could do that. And she's like, well, no, it's a little more involved. And so we talked and we set up an agreement on what we wanted to do and what she needed and what I didn't know and kind of what she, you know, was learning too. So we kind of worked together teaching each other stuff. But I knew that the best way to promote her would be to also be open to other people. And so that's why I started the blog. And then when I realized that authors were happy to share their works for reviews, and so that was, I love books, and so the idea of getting free books was awesome to me. And so then I just started my blog, and I just started asking authors, can I interview you? Can I talk to you? What do you know? How are you doing this? And then I would go back to Sherry, and I'd say, oh, guess what this person's doing, and guess what this person's doing? We need to do this, and we need to do that. And so it just kind of worked out from there.
And you have three short stories that you did write that you entered mm-hmm. and won awards for. Talk about those mm-hmm. for a minute, because one of those you did something with, correct?
Okay, I'm sorry. You broke up at the very end. What was the last thing you said?
One of those you're going to put into a series?
Yeah, one of them is the first one. There's a company out there called Readzy. I'm sure other people have heard about it. And every week they send out story prompts in email. And then you can submit your stories for the contest. And they choose one to win each week. And so my husband was up in New York and for work. And I was just busy and I was stressed and I just needed a distraction. So I decided to open the email and I read it. And it was all about an Easter egg hunt. But I wanted something to be a little bit different. So I created an Easter egg hunt where the rich people were going to forgive the debts of the poor people in town if you won the Easter egg contest. And then at the very last minute, they changed it from being regular Easter eggs to dragon eggs. And so the young lady in the story has to find a dragon egg and get it away from the mother and then deliver it to the social upper class type people in this town, and then her debts will be forgiven. And that is actually that and some work that I did with Sherry in the writing group has been the motivation or the inspiration, I guess, for the series I'm working on right now, and which will involve the egg hunt, but it's going to be a whole lot more expanded. Then the second story I won was again with Reezy, and it was based on the idea of you wake up and it's November 30th and you're participating in Nano, so you have a whole day to try to write all your words. And so I created a story about some aliens who came to this planet, and they really were very insistent upon getting a sequel to their favorite story. And if they didn't get the sequel to their favorite story, they were going to destroy the Earth.
So oh, my goodness.
That one
goodness.
Was just funny.
Sounds
and then the
very
third,
good.
The third story I wrote, it was actually a Halloween story, and then I just kept writing it and getting it better. But it's about a lady who's dying, and as she's dying, she sees her husband who comes, and he takes her out dancing. And her husband's dead as well, so she sees it, and then as she finally decides it's okay to go and to die, she dies, and then she and her husband go off dancing.
And I told her, ladies and gentlemen, I asked her where these could be found so y'all could go and read them. And she doesn't have them up on Kindle yet. So I told her she needed to put those up on Kindle because now y'all have a taste of it. Now, I know y'all are all scrambling going, where can we go get these? So, Terri, you're going to have to put them up on Kindle so folks can read about Terri Wilson, because they're marvelous stories, ladies and gentlemen. I just know they are. Now, why do you like to – I know why I like to read steampunk, but what is it about steampunk that is so fascinating to you?
I think at first it was the clothes. When you see people who are doing cosplay and they're dressed up in the corsets and, you know, all the fancy paraphernalia, I was really attracted because of that. And then I read my first steampunk novel, a series called Artifact Hunters. And I liked the concept of how you could have what seems like a historical novel, a little bit of fantasy twist to it, almost a historical fantasy. And they would take ordinary objects, but twist them just a little bit and make them modern, like something you would see in today's society. And then the more I got to know about it and the more I read some of the founding fathers of the steampunk movement, and I realized that it's a class war. It's the haves versus the have-nots. And, you know, I'm always somebody who goes for the underdog and somebody who, you know, who cheers on the person who comes from nothing and ends up, you know, being the president of the whole world or something. And so I like that too. And I think the third thing is just the women in the steampunk genre are really just like kick ass kind of women, you know, and I like that.
You like strong women. She likes to read and write about strong women, correct?
Yes.
That's why you do so well with Sherry's vampire series, because the women in that series is, ladies and gentlemen, you got to wait. The women in that series are extremely strong, but yet vulnerable.
Yeah, but I think they're, I like when I read a story that somebody says has a strong woman in it, but, you know, like she'll battle a bunch of demons and she'll, you know, go to the gates of hell and come back. And then she has to ask her boyfriend, what should we have for dinner? I don't like that.
No.
I think if you can go to the gates of hell and you can battle the demons, you should be able to figure out what you want for dinner. You don't need somebody to help you that. And so Sherry writes stories, you know, her women, they're vulnerable, but it's not at a point where it's going to make them weak or doesn't somehow take away from who they are. And so I really like that.
I think it enhances their strengths, the way that she writes her female characters.
Yes.
Now, you also, let's talk about being a recycled hippie. Now you millennials out there, I'm going to tell you what a hippie is. Back in the late 60s, it was getting toward the end of the Vietnam War, and my generation decided that they were going to make love, make peace, not war. So they called themselves hippies. They were flower children. Well, we're talking about the Woodstock era. What made you decide to be a recycled hippie?
I don't know that I really decided it. I think it's just kind of, I grew up in Texas, so our trends were probably 5 to maybe even 10 years behind everybody else in the country. So I grew up listening to music from that time period, and I've always had more of an affinity towards music from that, the Mamas and the Papas and, of course, the Beatles, you know, but everybody likes the Beatles. I don't know that makes you a hippie because you like the Beatles. But my, even like in the country music, which my dad was really into country music, I mean, Merle Haggard and Conway Twitty and the guy who sang the song about Trailer for Rent. I can't think of his name. And there was another guy who sang songs about like country stories and stuff. And I've always listened to that music more. But as I've gotten older, I just have this idea of the whole make love, not war. You know, I try to make sure that, you know, the people, that I want people to get along. I want people to like each other and to do nice things for each other. And that just sometimes seems a little archaic the way things are now. And so I'm also pretty crunchy, and, you know, I will, my kids always joke with me if something goes wrong, I'm always, you know, get the apple cider vinegar and put apple cider vinegar on it. That cures everything. Or, Eat some almonds. You need to eat some, you need to get some protein and some fat, and everything will be better. And so I think that's kind of why I could think of myself as a hippie.
Well, but the thing is, the almonds and the apple cider vinegar, those are tried and true old-time remedies.
Right.
Vinegar cures everything from acne to hemorrhoids.
Right.
If you're constipated, drink some vinegar. It works. Right. So, like, you didn't have enough to do with the children and writing and being the PA and doing all the things that you do, because children are like a 24/7 job too. Last year, you got this inspiration that you were going to be an editor for authors.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Not that it's a thing, but why?
You broke up again. I'm sorry. What was the last thing you said?
I just said, why? With everything that you have going on, the blog, the writing, the PA, and now you wanted to be an editor, which can be hair pulling. What in the world made you decide to want to do that?
Well, I was one of those really sick people that I love to diagram sentences. And, I mean, I would spend hours diagramming sentences. I loved that. And I've always been really fascinated by word choices and why you would choose leap instead of jump and things like that. And I also just, you know, I think indie authors really have an uphill battle to fight. And so I like the idea of working with smaller authors, working with indie authors, and trying to help them create the best story possible. I don't edit my own stuff, because when I read it, I never see the mistakes that are actually there. And so I think a lot of authors are like that, and I don't want them to, I want to give them a way to make it as perfect and as wonderful as possible. I read authors and they have these great, wonderful stories and they're just phenomenal. But sometimes I think like word choices gets in the way. Just like I said, like if I said, well, she jumped out the window, it doesn't give you the same picture as if I said she leaped out the window or she tumbled out of the window as opposed to she fell out of the window. And I worked a lot with Sherry on editing her stuff, and it was just fun. It was to sit down and figure out which, should it be a flower or the flower, and should it be sitting on the chair or sitting in the chair. It was just fun for me. And so that's why I started to do it.
And are you overwhelmed? Do you need more offers?
Say that one more time. I'm sorry. It's kind of breaking
That's
up a little
okay.
bit.
I said, are you overrun with editing services now? Are you still looking for more authors to edit?
I'm always open to that. I only do one at a time, though. So I try to make sure that I don't have, I'm not one of these editors. I hear about editors who have four or five projects going at once. I can't do that. So I'm probably slower than some of the other editors, but I would just rather work on one at a time. And that keeps me busy, but I mean, I'm always have a little bit more time to, and I'm always open to work with a new author. I've got a few of them that I work with now on a regular basis. And so that's really fun. I have one who's working on two series, and she keeps ending her series on a cliffhanger, and she will not tell me what's going to happen. She tells me I have to wait till the next book, and it just drives me crazy. So,
and you're the editor of these books, and she still won't tell you what's going to happen.
Mm-mm.
That's just wrong. That's just so wrong. So wrong. So let's talk a minute about your blog.
Okay.
You review books,
mm-hmm.
and you also interview authors. Now, are you picky about the genres that you review, or will you read just about anything?
Well, I don't really like to do nonfiction, how-to type books. I'm not, as you can, I'm sure this will surprise you, but I'm not really one to follow directions. And so I have a hard time with reviewing how-to books. So I don't like to do that. As far as fiction books go, I'm pretty open to just about anything. I haven't read any Westerns, but that's just because nobody's asked me to read Westerns. But I've done erotica and contemporary romance, and I've done Christian romance, fantasy, urban fantasy, just regular old, I guess what you'd call literature or women's literature, women's fiction type books. As long as it's a good story, I'm down for it.
When you interview authors, if someone wanted to be interviewed by you, could they contact you, or do you contact them? Do you have a limit? Because I know you used to do, I think it was on Tuesdays, you would put an author interview up on your blog. I think it was Tuesday. Do you
I
still
don't
do
like
that?
to interview. I only like to interview people that I've read. And so if you're an author out there and you want to hook up with me, I'd really like to read your stuff, at least one thing first, because then that just helps me develop a little bit more of a, I try to tailor, like a lot like you do, I try to tailor the interviews to what's specific about the author. And if I haven't read any of their stuff, then it makes it kind of difficult. The questions are just generic questions, and I would rather have something that's specifically geared towards the author. I am looking to do more interviews this next year and print them up and get them on the blog, as in addition to doing reviews. So if you're an author out there, you can connect with me, terriluvsbooks.com, my website, and we can always talk and work things out. I've got so many authors that I've read over this past year that I'm going to be connecting with them. If I've done a review for you and you, I'd like to interview you, so let's get together and let's talk about that too. So.
And you're right. You can't hardly do a productive interview if you haven't read the author or at least researched the author. It's like flying in the dark because you don't have anything to make that connection and make it personal.
Right. And
How hard?
I know this
Go
this
ahead.
was the, I was gonna say, I know this might sound kind of cheesy, but I almost feel like the authors that I work with, it's kind of like I'm saying, come be a part of my family. I want you in my group. I want you to, to be part of my, I don't want to say clique because that sounds so negative, but it's like, hey, come sit next to me at the cafeteria. Come sit at my table, And so it just makes it easier if I know the author. I can just get to know them even more through the interview.
Well, you have a common ground then if you've read something they've written. If nothing else, you can talk about the book till you do a little bit more deep dive and figure out who's on first. Then you can really get inside of their head and screw with them.
Right.
Yes, I'm evil. You know I'm evil. I can't help it. There is a name that I wrote down. The name is John Jakes. Does that ring a bell? Okay, let's talk about John Jakes because I put an exclamation point by that name.
Well, I think it's John Jakes. I think it's that he wrote the North and South books a long
Yes.
time ago. Okay. So when, again, I grew up in Texas in a very small town in Texas. It took us about 10 minutes to get from one side of town to the other. And that was with traffic and red stoplights. And so the library was an old house, actually, that somebody had given to the city, and they turned it into a library. And I came across North and South, and that was probably the first adult book I read, and it was probably a one that I necessarily shouldn't have read as a kid, but I really liked the story. I think stories that I had read up to that point, they were all, I mean, they were just kid stories. There wasn't a whole lot to them. But when I read this, and then I realized there was another one and another one and another one and another one, and it was like that was the first my first introduction to a series. And then it came out on TV and a miniseries, and that was just even more exciting. I had to just even read more and more and more. But I think that was my first introduction to, you know, character development and how a story, you can have a story that's encapsulated in a book, but that also another story that kind of overarches throughout an entire series.
And would it be safe to say, because like you, when I read that you got really bored with the kids' books and you were fairly young and moved on up to the more adult books, it reminded me of what happened to me in the library. I was like in second, third grade, and I was so sick of See Dick Run, Run Jane Run, See Spot, that I wanted to set fire to it. And I went to, like you, I went to the older book section, and the librarian politely informed me that I couldn't understand what I was reading, and I politely showed her I could, and I never looked back. So when I saw that, I said, yes, Terri is a person after my own heart, because our thirst for reading overshadowed our age at that time. Would that be a fair statement?
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely. I mean, there's some sexual things in that book, and I had no clue what I was reading as far as that goes, but just the story, I mean, the people, and, you know, he would describe the dresses that they wore in the antebellum time period and just the conflict, and it was, I just fell in love with that part of it.
Did you feel like a sponge soaking up liquid? You couldn't get enough, because what it did is it exploded your intelligence and your intellect and your desire to know more, because not only were you reading for enjoyment, but you were learning a part of history at the time too.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, absolutely. Because, I mean, you know, the history I was learning in school, I mean, it was dry. It was, you know, there was a battle. These guys fought. These many people died. This is where it happened. This is what it led to. And then, you know, chapter two, there was another battle and these people died. And so, I mean, it was boring. But when you read it in, you know, historical fiction, it's still one of my favorite books to kind of genres to read is historical fiction. It just brings things to life. And I'm sure most of it, there is quite a bit of historical fiction that leans on the fiction side of it. But it's just different than what you read in your history books.
Well, in the history books, it's just facts, and there's no visual conflict, and there's no visual dimension of the people in the history books. And like you, when we studied the wars, it didn't matter if it was World War I, World War II, the Crimean War, the Civil War. The dates didn't stick in my head. But as soon as I started researching the Civil War to write A Voice from the Grave, all of a sudden, you want to know something about the Civil War? I can give you dates, times, and telephone numbers, generals, battles. It's like a dance in my head, and it makes perfect sense. Whereas it's 1865, the South lost. Where was the surrender sign? I don't know. Now I know.
Yeah.
So I can understand your love for that.
One of my favorite things to do that we've done twice now, my husband and I have, is we've gone on these haunted historic ghost tours of various towns. And I I love it. Not that so much that they're not scary. I mean, it's not cheesy like a haunted house, but they talk about history that you don't know about in your history, in your textbooks, that they don't talk about in the textbooks. And it really brings it to life a whole lot more than, you know, than what the textbooks would bring it to life. So.
If you were to recommend to someone who wanted to start writing, what would you tell them?
I would probably tell them to go to the drugstore and buy a cheap spiral notebook. It doesn't have to be a lot. Don't. I've spent so much money on journals and notebooks because I wanted to get just the right perfect one. But just go get a spiral notebook and just kind of write down things that pop into your head and carry it with you all the time. And I would tell them, don't do what I do. Like, listen to one of those things, like, do as I say, not as I do. don't listen to those negative voices in your head. And just finish whatever you start, whether it's good or bad, just finish it. And you can always go back later and make it better. And then I would also encourage people, to read and not just read one genre. You can't just read romance, I think, and learn about good drama. I think you need to go out and find some other types of books. There's a lot of drama in fantasy, and there's a lot of romance in fantasy. And watch TV. I think there's a lot of good TV shows out there and a lot of good movies that teach you about plot points and beats of a story. And that sometimes is easier to get through than a big, huge book. So that's what I would say.
And you brought up a very good point. You should hear my husband and me when we're watching some of the crime shows that we watch, because that is our area of expertise. And we're both at the same time screaming at the writer saying, that would never happen in real life. And I have to keep reminding him, honey, it's just a TV show. It's entertaining. It's not for our critique. We have to just put that part of us aside. But we can't help it.
Yeah. But I think, I'm sure, like, when George Orwell did 1984, people were saying, oh, that doesn't happen in real life. That would never happen in real life. You know, when Margaret Atwood did her books, they would say that will never happen. That could never happen.
And then look at it.
It's so silly. I'm a huge Star Trek fan. I'm actually a geek. I'm probably a recycled hippie geek at heart. That's what I should start calling myself. But when you look at the Apple Watches now that they have, it's just like having a tricorder or just having that little button that they could push on their shirt.
Uh-huh.
You know, or when you have Siri, you come home and you say, Siri, turn on the lights. And, that's just like, or Alexa, turn on the lights. That's just like the James T. Kirk saying, computer, lights, please, or something.
You are exactly right.
So it's happening.
It is happening. And 1984 started happening in the 1980s. People just weren't paying attention. And I read that when I was in grammar school, and I was fascinated with it. You are not going to believe this, but our hour is almost up.
Everybody told me it would go fast.
And it does. It flies by. So before we run out of time, tell folks where you can be found so they can hook up with you.
Okay. Well, I'm on Facebook at Terri A. Wilson. And I'm on Instagram at Terri A. Wilson and Twitter at Terri A. Wilson. You'll see a theme going here. My website is terriluvsbooks.com. And you can also email me either at terriluvsbooks@gmail.com or terri@terriluvsbooks.com. Make sure you spell the loves, L-U-V-S, not L-O-V-E-S. You can also just Google. I think if you just Google Terri Loves Books and you spell it right, you'll find me. So, and you can connect. Connect with me anywhere. It's good. I'm on Tumblr too, but I don't go there very often.
I've used Tumblr for years. In fact, when I put the show up, it goes up on Tumblr too. Plus Google Plus. It goes up on Tumblr. It goes up on Google Plus. It goes up on, what's the other? Of course, it goes up on Facebook and Twitter. But the links, if somebody Googles Terri A. Wilson or Terri Wilson, it's going to pop up all the podcast that this show's going up on.
It'd be good if you could just do, make sure you get the A in it, because there's another Terri Wilson out there in the world and the universe. I think she's a realtor.
Yes,
And so
I found her.
I always do the Terri A. Wilson, because then that just helps me stand out a little bit more.
And she is a standout, ladies and gentlemen. Trust me. You want to hook up with this woman because she's fascinating. I absolutely adore her. And join us in June if you're in the Melbourne area, the Melbourne, Florida area, because, I mean, Cocoa Beach, not Melbourne. If you're in the Cocoa Beach, Florida area, at the International Palms, we've been doing an event May 31st to June the 3rd. We will have books and authors and signings and all kinds of stuff going on. So join us there. Tomorrow night, I am probably taking off the guest that I had. She is not going to be able to make it, so I'm probably going to take tomorrow night off. Friday night, author Andy Daugherty will be here. And Saturday night, graphic designer James Carlson will be with us. Then on January the 2nd at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, we're doing a special show with a author from the UK. And his name is Oliver Newton. And we do it at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, because if I do it at 9 o'clock at night, it's like 3 o'clock in the morning there. So join us then. January the 4th, author Linda Tillis will be with us. January the 5th from 8 to 9, I'm probably going to cut it a little bit short, author C.W. Thomas, because that is also the night at 9 o'clock Eastern Standard Time that I will be on the show Married with Children on Investigation Discovery. And then January the 6th, author Gary Starter will be with us again. So ladies and gentlemen, the year is starting out with a bang. I have no idea where 2018 is going to take us, but I know that I want to bring Terri back. And Terri, I don't hang up when the show goes dark, but I did want to say thank you so much. And I hope you're not nervous anything, because it's just a friend to have a conversation and it flies by.
Well, thank you. Thank you. I really appreciate it.
Well, I've had fun. I don't know about you, but I've had fun. So, ladies and gentlemen, y'all know that there are several things that I say at the end of the show, because this show is very important to me, and I hope that it is extremely important to each of you. And if I make a difference in one person's life, then my job here is done. And one of the things I say is, don't feel special, be special, because if you just feel special, you will never be special. And if you want to achieve greatness, would you please stop asking permission, because nobody's going to give it to you. Because they're too busy living their own lives and wallowing in their own self-pity. So if you start asking permission to achieve greatness, they're going to keep you down in the mire with them, and you'll never be great. The difference between who you are and who you want to be is what you do. Now think about that. The difference between who you are right now and who you might want to be tomorrow is what you do today. So if you want to be somebody else tomorrow, I would suggest you get busy changing it today. Change what you do. Change the way you think. Change the people that you hang with. Change everything about yourself. Because that's the only way that you'll be different tomorrow. Your smile is your logo. Your personality is your business card. And the way that you leave others feeling after having had that experience with you, ladies and gentlemen, that is your trademark. People will forget what you look like. They will forget your name. They will even forget what you're wearing. But they will never, ever, ever forget the way you made them feel. And if you don't believe me, try it. And I hope that every guest and every listener that comes on this show never forgets the way that I've made them feel. And I hope it's been a good experience for them, because that is my goal, is that everyone that comes on this show, whether as a listener, whether as a guest, or whether even somebody that's advertising, that when they're through having an experience with me, they feel good about who they are. Because we're all traveling on a journey, and none of us know what kind of journey the other one is traveling. So, and it makes us feel good, too. You know, when you smile at someone who's having a bad day, you automatically feel better. So with that being said, I want to thank Terri A. Wilson. Check that out. Terri A. Wilson at Terri LUVSBooks. And find her on Facebook. Authors, get on her blog. Until tomorrow night Friday night at 8 o'clock Central Time, this is your host, Yvonne Mason, with Off the Chain, saying good night. told you it flies by. We are off the air now, but what I wanted to tell you is that when we get off the phone, the show will go up into archives. Once it archives, I'm going to post it on my page, and I'm going to tag you in it. And I want you to take that, and I want you to put it everywhere. Put it on your blog. Put it everywhere so folks can learn about you. Tomorrow, I'm going to put it up on podcast.com, Podcast Garden, Spreaker, SoundCloud, and Mixcloud. When I do that, I will also put those links on my page and tag you in it, and you can spread that around as well.
Okay.
Everybody in God's going to know who Terri A. Wilson is.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Thank you so much.
Fun.
You are so welcome, and I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did, Terri. It was a blast, and I want you to come back, if you will.
Yeah, I will. I will. It's my goal to get this book done and next year, and maybe even by Space Coast, and I'll come back then.
Okay, and we'll launch the book on the show.
Sounds good.
That'll be fun. All right, my darling, and see, it wasn't as bad as having a tooth pulled.
Oh, God, no. Considering that I have to have laughing gas.
Our root canal. See, it wasn't that bad at all.
All right, listen, Happy New Year. And I hope that things go well with your husband and the spot on his nose.
Thank you, my darling, and Happy New Year to you and your family. And I can't wait to see you.
All right, thank you. Good night, Yvonne.
Good night, Terri. Bye-bye.